How's it going, everybody? It's your bro here, hope you're doing well, and in this video, we're going to be discussing dynamic polymorphism in Java, so let's get into it. If you find this video helpful, please remember to like, comment, and subscribe. Your support will help keep this channel running. Alright everybody, so we're going to be discussing dynamic polymorphism, and I know that sounds somewhat intimidating, but it's not too bad once you break down the vocabulary. So, what we learned in the last video on polymorphism is that polymorphism is a Greek term. Poly means many, and then morph means either shape or form. And when you put those two together, it means many shapes or forms. So, picture a Corvette. A Corvette can have many shapes and forms. It identifies as one, a Corvette. It also identifies as a car, also as a vehicle, and it also identifies as an object. Now, the word dynamic, that means in programming, after the compilation phase, after the program compiles. So this is during runtime, after the program is already running. So when you combine these two words together, dynamic polymorphism, it's the ability of an object to take many shapes or forms after the program is already running. So what we're going to be doing for this video is declaring an object of the animal class, which we have to make still, and we'll call this object animal. And we'll give the user two choices. They can have a dog or a cat. So we're going to end up either declaring this as an instance of the dog class and use the dog constructor, or use the cat constructor, but we don't know quite yet. So we're going to ask the user during runtime. So for now, we're only going to declare that we want an animal of the animal class, but we don't know if they're going to be a dog or a cat. They're going to assume one of those forms. So let's create a few classes. So within your project folder, you can right click, go to new, class, and let's create an animal class. And this is going to be the parent class for dog and cat. So that's good for now. Let's head back to our project folder and create a dog class. So dog is going to extends animal, because dog is the child class of animal, and let's create a cat class. So cat, finish, cat extends the animal class. Let's also give these classes maybe just one method. So we'll make this a public void method, and let's call it speak. So this animal is going to say something relevant to the type of animal that it is. So maybe cat goes meow. And let's do the same thing for dog. And I'll just copy this, paste it, and we'll change cat to dog. Dog goes bark. And let's do the same thing for animal, even though we don't have to. So what's something generic that all animals say? I can't really think of anything, so I'm just going to make up something. Animal goes brrrr. So the speak method for the dog class and the speak method for the cat class are actually overridden methods. They're overriding the speak method of the animal class. So it's considered good practice to add a note that says override to let other users know that this is a overridden method. And if we instantiate an object of the dog class or the cat class, it's going to use its associated speak method compared to the generic speak method for the animal class. Now let's head back to our main class. So what we're going to be doing is prompting the user to type in if they want a dog or a cat, and then we're going to instantiate an object of that type, of that specific form. So let's create a prompt, but we'll need a scanner first. So let's create an instance of a scanner. So scanner, let's call it scanner with a lowercase s, equals new scanner, then within parentheses, system.in. And then we'll need to import something. So make sure you have this import at the top. Now let's create a prompt for the user. So we'll system.out.println, what animal do you want? And then we'll give them two choices. So maybe we'll do this on a second line. So maybe we'll type in one equals dog or two equals cat. Maybe I'll just make this a print statement. Okay, and then let's give the user a choice. So we'll assign this to a variable. So we'll make this an integer because it's going to store a number. So int choice equals scanner.nextInt. All right. So then we're going to have a few if statements here. So if choice is equal to 1, what we'll do is that we're going to take our animal object and we're going to finish instantiating this. So new, and we're going to use the dog constructor. We're going to construct this animal as a dog, and then we'll have this animal use its speak function. So this is going to be an overridden method. It's going to use this specific overridden method for dogs. Let's do the same thing for the cat. So we'll change this to an else if statement, choice equals 2, animal equals new cat, and we'll use the cat constructor. The animal will still use its speak method, and then else, they must have typed in something wrong. We'll instantiate this with the animal class. So new animal, use the animal constructor. System.out.print line, that choice was invalid. And then maybe we'll use the animal.speak method as well. All right, let's test this. What animal do you want? Let's pick a dog. I like dogs. Dog goes bark. And let's try it again. What animal do you want? I want a cat this time. Cat goes meow. And let's try this one last time. Let's make up a random number. I like the number 42. That choice was invalid. Animal goes brrrr. So that's one of the benefits of dynamic polymorphism. You can declare an object and make space for it in memory, even if you don't know what type of object you want quite yet. So for example, we said that we want an animal and we're going to make room in our program for an animal, but we don't know quite yet what kind of animal it's going to be. And in our case, we're not sure if this animal is going to be a dog or a cat. So here's a few other examples of dynamic polymorphism. So do you remember in pretty much any game from the Pokemon series, you had to choose if you were a boy or a girl? Well, you could declare that your data type is a human as a placeholder, but you're going to use the appropriate game sprite for a boy or a girl once you make your decision. Otherwise, let's take World of Warcraft. So you have to pick a character class, but when you first create your character, you don't have one picked out quite yet. So you have to later decide if this character is going to be a paladin, a hunter, a mage, etc. And then once this object does assume a form during runtime, it's going to inherit everything from the parent classes, and if there's any methods that are overridden, they're going to use these overridden methods in place of any previous methods that they might have had. So that's the basics of dynamic polymorphism. If you want a copy of all this code, I'll post all of this in the comments down below. But, well, yeah, that's the basics for dynamic polymorphism in Java. Hey, you. Yeah, I'm talking to you. If you learn something new, then you can help me help you in 3 easy steps by smashing that like button, drop a comment down below, and subscribe if you'd like to become a fellow bro.